meeting on December 14th, 2017, 6 o'clock p.m. And we stand for a moment of silence and the Pledge of Allegiance led by Mr. Massey.
Please turn to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Ms. Jones, can you roll call, please?
Mayor Jerome.
Here.
Ms. Hope.
Here.
Ms. Gillett.
Here.
Mr. Ralston.
Here.
Mr. Tucker.
Here.
Mr. Frail. Mr. Massey.
Here.
Thank you. Time for public comments, and this time, time for you to come up in 3 minutes, about 3 minutes, and please state your name and address. And if you have any questions, we're going to probably answer those questions at the on our website. If we get, and Ms. Hayes will answer something. If any questions need to have me to answer, she can maybe deliver an answer tonight for you. Other than that, we have Mary Miller. I have one card.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Mayor Jerome, council members, and Ms. Hayes. On behalf of the Serenity Park here, better? Can you hear me?
No,
ma'am. Oh, I'm sorry. Mary Miller, 200 East 10th Avenue, Mount Doyle. On behalf of the Serenity Park team, I'm here tonight to sincerely thank you for helping us through phase one. The fantastic park appearance speaks for itself, and it's definitely being used. This evening, I would like to share a few serenity moments. One of our wheelchair citizens frequently uses the Tremaine Trail, and just before the water fountain was installed, thanks to a community trust grant, I mentioned to this gentleman that there would be a level for him to drink from easily. He became emotional and tears welled, and he said thank you. Most recently, two young boys were riding their bikes full steam ahead toward the park. Just a little concerned, we watched as they very gently parked their bikes in the bicycle rack, thanks to Councilwoman Laurie Tillett. Almost any day around 2 o'clock, you will find a gentleman with Parkinson's sitting on a bench doing his exercises. And if a path can be worn in concrete, it will be to the busy Water Tower Library. Serenity Park is now entering phase two. Despite the number of trees, there is no shade in the central gathering area. As shown in our original site plan, we are now researching pavilion, pergola, and other shade possibilities. We will also be adding more plants, including butterfly attractors, and a bicycle repair station is still planned to be placed by the bike rack. For phase two, private donations and a second engraved brick program will cover many of our smaller goals. To accomplish our major goal, we are seeking support through grants. If you haven't already, please visit your City of Mount Dora, Serenity Park. In closing, I would like to present this very small token of our appreciation to Mayor Jerome for his support and for suggesting the perfect name, Serenity.
That wishes to come in front of council, speak on any item not on the agenda. Did you all hear me? Okay, good. Okay, seeing none, we have some presentations tonight, and the first one is from, let me guess, Hosanna Botto on the Patriots Cruise.
Rosanna Bacco, 541 East First
Park your horse.
Avenue.
Very good.
You know where I'm going to park it when this is over. Sorry about that. That doesn't take up my minutes.
It was the perfect response.
You haven't made the recording.
Right. Oh, God, that's right. We're on TV. And my husband, Carol Jaskolski, who's my partner in this. Thank you, Mayor Jerome, for asking us to make this presentation because the picture's worth a thousand words. A lot of you are going to see your pictures, or you're going to be on video on this. That's because you all help us. As I've said a million times, we cannot do it without the city of Mount Dora and all of the departments. It is an amazing day. And the takeaway I'd like for you to have when you watch this and you think about it, one of our veterans this year, young veteran who's suffering from severe PTSD, asked me for the address of Gilbert Park, and I gave it to him, and he said he liked to Google Earth any place that he's going because he likes to have an escape route in case anything goes bad. There's always something every year that grabs my heart, and that's what grabbed it this year, because you don't forget a statement like that. And if these guys and women are willing to serve and come away from it with that sort of life that they're living with, then what we do is nothing compared to that. As big as this event has gotten with all your help, that's what you need to think about when you watch this.
Should we dim the lights? Will that help? What happened to the sound?
I don't know. Hold on 1 second.
Okay.
Okay, we're back on.
Turn it up.
Turn the volume up.
Hold on 1 second.
No, the sound was over on the right.
Oh.
Push it over there.
Mm-hmm. Oh, thank you.
Here's telling our children and our children's children what it was once like in the United States where men were free.
You're not starting
it
off.
No, not at all.
Because of our vet.
That's an important part of it.
Okay.
Freedom is not free. In the words of Ronald Reagan, 40th President of the United States, freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, and handed on for them to do the same. Or one day, we will spend our sunset years telling our children and our children's children what it was once like in the United States where men were free. It is because of our veterans that we are free.
Thank you.
Our city is proud to be one of the sponsors of the Patriots Cruise, and it honors you, the veterans, who put yourselves in harm's way to allow future generations to enjoy freedom. Some of our younger generations still have a problem realizing that freedom is not free, that someone has to pay for it. Past generations of patriots like yourselves gave the ultimate sacrifice so that they have the right to speak up and express themselves. I just wish that more of them would learn that without your willingness to serve and carry our nation's flag to the highest sense of honor, that they would not have their freedom of expression.
Just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, because the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say.
With this program?
Yeah, we kind of do that ourselves, even though we've seen it 100 times. It's a tough day, but it's joyful.
Okay, we have a certificate of achievement for excellence and financial reporting to the finance department, presented by Ken Burke, clerk of the court of Pinellas County.
First of all, I want to say I know how the person who was told they would be singing right after Elvis Presley fell. Tough act to follow. Beautifully, beautifully done. Very, very inspiring. And it's notable that Councilwoman Tillotson was telling us and we were sharing about her Army experience. So thank you for your service and that of your son. You did tough work there. It is good to be with you this evening. My name is Ken Burke, as your mayor mentioned. I certainly am honored to have the opportunity to present to the city council, to your city manager, and to a fellow finance officer tonight, a certificate of achievement in financial reporting. I am the Pinellas County, which is St. Petersburg, Clearwater County, clerk of the circuit court and comptroller, a finance officer too. And I'm also here in my capacity as secretary treasurer of the Florida Government Finance Officers Association. I do want to say I have some connection to Mount Dora though. Today at lunch, I was sitting with our state attorney, a longtime state attorney. He's been our state attorney since 1992, the elected state attorney. Bernie McCabe grew up in Mount Dora, went to high school, junior high school, elementary school here. Very proud citizen for many years of Mount Dora. When he went to college, not too far away, at Stetson over in DeLand, and then went to our law school in Pinellas County. And also, when I was in college in the early 80s, my good friend was the editor of the Mount Dora Topic, and I would make it over here and visit him, and that was his first job out of the University of Florida. His first journalism job was as editor of the Mount Dora Topic. So I feel I kind of know Mount Dora from my visits here. You don't have nearly as many orange groves around y'all as you used to in the early 80s. It is your job, and I think it is appropriate based on the quote that was said, freedom isn't free, that President Ronald Reagan mentioned, because what you're doing here today, this is about what freedom's about. It's a city council meeting, hearing from the citizens, deciding important matters, and also living your fiduciary and trustee responsibility. And that's an extremely big task each of you have, is to ensure that the citizens' money, it's not your money, it's the citizens' money that's been entrusted to you, that you are good stewards of that money. And you do that through a city manager and through an excellent finance officer to make sure that you're doing the good work for the people and being good stewards of the citizens' money. And that's what this award is about tonight. It's about recognizing that achievement, excellence in financial reporting. That is done through, I'm a CPA, so kind of nerdy with this type of thing, our comprehensive annual financial report. But I can tell you, the GFOA, when they review this, it is not a simple review. It is a very rigorous review of your CAFR to ensure that it meets the high standards of financial reporting. Your CAFR, which is prepared by your finance staff, the auditors audit this. The auditors only give a 3-page document in here. The rest of it is done by your finance staff. John, I would like to call you forward. And you've made a wonderful selection in bringing John on here in Mount Dora. John is highly recognized throughout the state of Florida for his expertise as a finance officer. As y'all know, he has many, many years in involvement as a finance officer, but also he has served on our state board for the past 4 years and chaired several state committees. He's extremely well thought out of throughout the state and brings honor to Mount Dora through his association now with Mount Dora. So John, on behalf of the Government Finance Officers Association, and I want to say another thing about this certificate, which is not a certificate, it's heavy as can be, is that not only should you get a feeling of satisfaction that you are meeting the high standards of financial reporting, but your bonding agencies, and I know you have enterprise debt, a little bit of government debt, but when they consider the rating, they look at, and one of the areas they look to, do you have the certificate of achievement? If you have that, that helps you with a favorable bond rating, which means that your interest rate is lower, saving the taxpayers money. So that's a very, very good thing. So this is not only a certificate, which is something you can put on the wall, but it's also something which saves the taxpayers money. And you should feel a sense of pride in the folks who preceded you, because this is the 23rd year that the city of Mount Dora has earned the Certificate of Excellence in Finance Reporting. So it's my honor to present this to John McKinney on behalf of the Government Finance Officers Association.
This isn't an award that's given to the finance director. This is an award that's given to the finance department. None of this that we do, putting CAFRs together, budgets together, can be done by one person. It's done by a team, and you have a wonderful team upstairs. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, do I have a motion to approve tonight's agenda?
So moved.
Second. Any changes, anything needs to be done?
Aye.
Okay, approval of the minutes from our city council meeting dated, they're not here tonight, they're going to be coming on January 2nd. Okay, discussion items, Dogger Mountain update, Ms. Hayes.
Thank you, Mayor and council members. I'd like to ask John Peters to come up to the podium and give you a quick update on Dogwood Mountain. Since our last meeting, again, we try to bring this up during each of the meetings so that our citizens can hear the update, whether they listen to us on Facebook or just dial into us at a later point in time so that they understand and know what's going on, as well as the fact that we do send out emails to that list of citizens who ask to be included in the loop. Mr. Peters.
Since last week, the main thing that we're still waiting for the detailed estimate from the contractor. We've gotten all the other paperwork that the federal government was asked for through the U.S. Department of Agriculture. So once we have that detailed estimate, supposedly this week, we will forward that along and we will wait USDA to tell us how much funding they can give us. We really cannot start construction until we know the status of that that funding. And quite frankly, USDA potentially is a lot more money than we would ever get from FEMA. So it's definitely something to work to wait for. So hopefully next time we meet on January 2nd, I can report that we have sent everything in, maybe even have an answer to what kind of funding we might get. Okay,
thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. Service line warranty. Mr. Peters, before you sit, would you like to introduce the company, or do you want them to come up? So, ladies.
You sound that perfect.
So if you'll state your name and your address for the record and just your presentation from that point.
Thank you. Well, good evening, Mayor Girone and honorable council members. Thank you for allowing us to be in warm Florida instead of very, very cold New York. My name is Monica Vasale. I'm the Director of Account Management for Service Line Warranties of America. I'm here with my colleague, Tara Quinn, who is the Senior Account Manager, who is responsible for the relationship with the City of Mount Dora. We wanted to take the opportunity again to thank you for allowing us to be here, but also, John, for allowing us this opportunity to come and speak to everybody. Our goal for today is really threefold. We want to provide a bit of information of who we are and what we do. I know that there are some council members that are new that might have not been here from the start. In particular, we want to speak about our program and our customer service experience, and then we want to open it up to some questions. I had the opportunity of viewing the last council meeting, and I know that there were some very good questions, and we hope that today we're able to address those. If not, we promise we'll get you those as a follow-up. I did prepare a brief presentation. Service Line Warranties of America is the largest provider of water and sewer line protection programs in the U.S. and Canada, and is endorsed by the National League of Cities. Servicing customers for over a decade now, we protect over 3 million homeowners across 4.5 million coverage plans. And today have more than 450 municipal, city, and utility partnerships. We are committed to customer service, ethical marketing practices, and maintaining an A+ rating with the Better Business Bureau. Today, 98.6% of our customers are satisfied after services were provided by SLWA. later on, we'll share some more statistics and measures and tools that we use to track customer service, just to give you a broader perspective of how we do this. The City of Mount Dora entered into an agreement with Service Line Warranties of America to educate customers on their responsibilities and provide optional low-cost plans for water, sewer, and in-home plumbing pipe emergencies that occur on their property. Our program is fundamentally based on the fact that homeowners don't necessarily know what's underground or the condition of their pipes. According to the U.S. Census, about 42% of homes in Mount Dora are over 38 years old. And 67% of homeowners across the U.S., based on some surveys we've done, conducted by Ipsos, don't know what their homeowners' responsibilities are, that the lines on their line, on their property, are their responsibilities, in fact. A lot of times, if something happens, the first person they will turn to, is their utility company. Utility companies then have to turn them away and say, I'm sorry, we can't help you. And then a staggering 63% of Americans don't have enough funds to cover a $500 emergency. This is why, like with the City of Mount Dora, we partner with hundreds of cities. There's two key elements of our program. The first is education. At the expense of us, of SLWA, we mail to your customers to explain their responsibilities and just let them know types of repairs and what those might cost. As part of our education, the marketing piece is very important, and we can't do it without the city. We want to make sure that what we're mailing to your customers is speaking to the customers in the tone that the City of Mount Dora expects and how you speak to your customers. We want to work together on what that messaging is to ensure we're addressing all those concerns, especially if you're getting calls from customers. Those are the types of feedback that we want to know, because we're able to address it in our materials to make sure we're proactive in addressing those concerns before the next mailers go out. In addition to the branding and the marketing and the first element, we want to provide a solution. We explain to homeowners their responsibility. We explain the costs associated with emergency repairs, but then we want to provide them with a solution. So all of the plans that we offer are optional. We do our very best to make sure that that's very transparent in all of the upfront materials. I think throughout a mailer, we might have the word optional in 7 different locations, because that's how important it is for us to make sure that customers and your residents know it's not an insurance that's mandatory. It's not what you need to get a mortgage like an insurance. This is an optional program. It's complementary to what a homeowner's insurance would offer. So versus a homeowner's insurance, it's mandatory to get a mortgage, and you need it to cover yourselves from robbery, fires, we provide warranty service plans that complement and cover the things that most typical homeowner's insurance don't cover. I want to focus on the next few slides and hope that I'll be able to address some of those questions that came up in the last meeting. Specifically, customer service. Customer service is the crux of our business. Today, we are servicing a customer every 78 seconds each day. In order to do this, we all at Service Line Warranties of America have to live and breathe our customer promise, which is we put the customer at the heart of everything we do. Without that, we would not have a successful company. And starting with that is our contractor selection process. To become a contractor in our network, you have to go through a rigorous process. You have to be an A plus or an A or above rated by the BBB. You have to go through extensive background screening, drug tests, you know, the whole nine. I'll give you some additional examples. Pardon me. You have to show certification of licenses, references of previous jobs, and for example, if you're a reputable company, we expect that the name of your company is represented on your trucks, your men are in uniform, their names are apparent, and that customers know when you're getting there who you are. So transparency, again, is very important to us. And lastly, I want to spend some time to share the not one, but several tools that we as an organization utilize to measure and track customer service. It's very important to us that we know what's going on so that we can get ahead of things proactively instead of reactively. We are constantly working towards improving customer satisfaction with different metrics that are assessed and reviewed on a daily, weekly, and monthly basis, continually evaluating and assessing each touch point of the customer life cycle to make certain we are delivering exceptionally high standards. Starting with the first one, I earlier on mentioned that we have a 98.6% customer satisfaction. These are post-claim surveys. After a job is completed, we will attempt to reach the customer and ask them a series of questions. What we're measuring there is the experience from the initial call into our customer service to the actual output of the job. How satisfied were they? If anything falls below a certain rating of dissatisfied, we're out reaching out to that customer to find out what was it about that experience that was not satisfactory and how can we make it better. Today, as an organization, we have nearly a 99% customer satisfaction, something we're very proud about and something that, again, goes to us putting the customer at the heart of everything we do. One of the next tools that we use is Rant and Rave. This is more for our customer service agents. It allows our customers the ability to share their views, capturing how they really feel, and then we can take that real time and act upon it. So when a customer calls in, we see the sentiment, and if something shows up in red, our agent is able to understand or see that this customer is not happy, and we're making right by the customer. So we're reaching out to the customer to find out, again, what is it about the experience, whether it be from the marketing to the actual job, what was it about your experience with our company that you were dissatisfied of? Then we have Revu. Revu is, it takes impartial feedback. We have no control whatsoever of this company. It's a third-party independent company that we use. The purpose is to provide complete transparency. It allows customers to voice their opinions in an uncensored open environment, which is displayed on our website. Independent customer surveys rate us 4.5 out of 5. Again, we have no control over what the customer puts on our website, and it's public information, and we're proud to say it's a 4.5 out of 5. And lastly is our Net Promoter Score. That's to gauge customer loyalty. How likely is a customer going to recommend our company to a friend or family member? And I'm happy to say that today we have an 84 out of 100. So that's comparable to the Amazons of the world, the Nordstroms, and some of these big box retailers. So again, we're very, very proud of our customer service, and we take a lot of pride in making sure that we're always doing right by the customer. So I hope with that, I was able to give enough of an overview. Apologies if I went by really quickly. I couldn't top for the presentations before, so I didn't want to bore anybody. But with that, I'd love to open it up to some questions, and Tara and I can address.
Thank you, Mayor. I value and appreciate that additional information you've given us. I think it's my memory this year when I voted to approve your doing what you do to the residents of Mount Dora. I still support the program. Let me tell you a story. So one morning about 11 o'clock, I received a telephone call from a constituent in my district, and his first question was, "Cal, are you aware of the scam that's going on in Mount Dora?" I said, "No, I haven't gotten any letter in the mail. It was in my mail that afternoon." And he explained it to me, and he said, "The city of Mount Dora's logo, one of the logos, is on there, and they're using Mount Dora to sell this product." Then it dawned on me, and I explained to him that it is not a scam, that it was approved by the city council, but I said my understanding was that your organization, before the letters were sent out, were supposed to get it cleared or reviewed by our manager before, so there were no surprises, so we could do marketing and do it correctly, for so so these types of calls weren't there. I have received about a dozen or more of those calls afterwards about what is this deal. And I think it's because, even though I fully support it for the reasons you mentioned, I fully support it because it's an option and it helps educate homeowners, and those are two good things. But I think you might have been better prepared through our manager to prepare the citizens of this city for what's going to come for the logo of our city on there. And not everybody reads the websites, and not everybody does that. So it was a surprise to many people. I'm still answering those questions, and I still give them a positive, feel free, it's an option for you, read it over carefully. And so I continue to support the program, but my honest critical comments are, that's where the failure was that initial failure to contact our manager and prepare the residents for that. Just a comment, there's maybe nothing you can do about it now, but maybe there is. Thank you very much.
And I think also with that, the sizing was the brand makes it look very fake. So when someone provides, as we did, a JPEG or something, that you take that into consideration and use the full size, because it did look very, very fake on the letter. It didn't match what we normally send out. I mean, that's just one thing that that's we would say. And I'll let the rest of, I'll make other comments later.
Thank you. And I'm going to speak for a couple minutes. One on using the Mount Dora logo. That's not new with your company. You do it with every city you go into, it looks like. I've gone back and found, going back to 2013, customers and cities were questioning the same thing. Why is our logo, are we endorsing you? Are we promoting you? And so in 4 years, the company has not changed. It's still, I don't doubt that if you sell your product to Timbuktu next week, Timbuktu's logo is going to be on your next mailing to their customers. Now with that, I've got some questions about your company. And this is went on a couple different websites. And granted, there's always a squeaky wheel.
Yeah.
Okay. Literally, I'm glad you have a 99% rating, because I found 18 complaints. Okay. Well, newest complaint, you had two of them from December 8th. Complaints range everywhere from El Dorado, Kansas, to San Diego, Arlington, Texas, Toronto, around the country. Numerous issues. Everything, every day, you sign up for the company, you get a password or something to go in so you can check your site or something, your balances or your payments. But one complained about a password issue. Another one talked about your contractor. Before the gentleman signed up, he wanted to know what companies you contracted with. That particular, your company, further complaint. So we're not telling you who we use. Sign up and they'll come out. Now, I'll be honest with you, there's a company in this town that I would not let on my property. I don't care if they show up in a uniform and a shiny white truck. They're not coming on my property and try to rip me off for $7,000. They're not coming on. I would want to know what company you use. There's another woman wanted to know, it goes on and on. Billing, they're paying, they're not being credited, they're calling up. And I don't know who these people are calling, but a whole lot of the problem stems with your customer service. Complaint after complaint is they have a complaint to begin with, they're calling your customer service department, and they're hanging up on them. They're giving them negative, they're arguing with them instead of trying to address their issue. Now, I don't know that the people who are calling are not Attila the Hun and they were mad to begin with. But I do know your customer service people, from reading these, are hanging up on everybody. I saw one complaint where the woman complained on basically she complained on August 10th. And customer service, she described it as rude, but she finally got a response November 2nd. And that was your company responding to her on the website November 2nd. So 2.5 months later, somebody's finally reaching out to her from your company. And it goes on and on like this. And one of the things I also noted was you had two positives that I saw. You saw 18 negatives, two positives. They were both in 2016. And what struck me as odd, they were both written the same day. Both positive complaints were written the same day. And I got 30 years in federal law enforcement. And if I was writing both letters, I'm not going to say they were layovers, but some of the wording was identical. I mean, it could have been a quirk. I don't know. But I raised an eyebrow at it when I read them. Because each one of them, most of the complaints and the responses go on for a couple sentences. These both went on for a couple paragraphs. And I thought it was odd that they were both written the same day and very similar in the wording. And one thing I didn't understand, I see you saw your A-plus rating on one of the websites, and forgive me, I don't know if it was the Better Business website that I was on or the SWL reviews and review and rating website, but they had a customer service rating. In 2013, you were rated 5 out of 5. 2015, you were rated 5 out of 5. 2017, your rating dropped to 2 out of 5.
I'm sorry, where was that rating?
Was that, I believe, was on a website that said SLW review.
SLWA? Okay.
Yeah.
Wait, is it just SWL?
I don't.
Because there is another website out there that's SWL.
There was one of them said SWL, and one on that, and it said it wasn't there anymore.
Okay, I see, because that's not us. There's another company out there. I just want to pick
it. Yeah. That one's not there anymore, because I went to that website too. But this was on the Better Business website, or this service line warranty website.
Okay.
But it had, again, both of them had pros and cons. I did find two positives, but that was on Angie's list, and that was good.
Okay.
But it was 2016 and 2015. And they said I could go in and find more information, but I had to sign up to be on Angie's list. Mm-hmm. And love you long time, but I'm not signing up to go on Angie's list, okay? I've got some serious questions about some of your response to your customers, and I just, I find it troubling. I'm glad you've been around almost 20 years. You've got, I don't know very bad companies that are around 20 years, so I take my hat off to you for that. But recently, with what I'm seeing in your complaints, I've got some troubling issues. And the fact that you've been called on the carpet before, but it looks like by every city that you go into for using their logo in your advertising, but still refuse to change. I've got some issues with that too. I would think at some point in time somebody would say to the mayor or the city manager, hey, we're going to use your website and our advertising to your customers. Do you have an issue with that? And apparently it's, no, we're just going to do it. And kind of, if they call us on the carpet for it, they call us on the carpet for it. So I guess at this meeting, we're kind of calling you on the carpet for it.
So in regards to the branding and using the city seal specifically?
Yes, ma'am.
So with all of the partnerships and all the cities we work with, they're a part of the approval process. They're fully working with us on reviewing all of the pieces. If there's an issue, we're working and addressing that together.
You're here tonight in part because of the advertising using the city logo. No one on this council knew you were going to do that.
Oh, yes, we did.
I'm sorry.
It was part of the resolution and the whole package. Mm-hmm. I think the first problem, John can speak, but the problem we had with it initially, we didn't know when it was going out. Did reach out to Public Works. You worked with them on the wording. But then all of a sudden, all of our citizens had these letters. We didn't have an opportunity to send anything to them in the mail. We didn't have an opportunity to do a press release, to put anything on the website, or to educate them. Even though it was presented back in the spring, that's a lot of time difference. 6 months before, that we're able to even let them know or even give them an avenue to ask questions, all of a sudden they have it. So we just didn't feel that there was a reasonableness in reaching out, working with them to have them look at the letter and then to let us know what's going out. This council should have known. We could have announced it at 2 or 3 meetings. We have Facebook. We could have let the citizens know.
all the calls coming in that it was fake or that there was a scam, probably all but four people would have, you know, I mean, it would have narrowed it down to four or five calls at that point in time. So that's one of the staff's issues anyway, from that perspective. And I think you could definitely work better on that side of it. We work with a lot of companies. They send us press releases. We adjust them. We have a PIO. She would have reached out to everyone that's part of the social media process and the website. We could have used our daily commercial. We could have used the buzz. We had a lot of avenues, but we didn't have that opportunity.
Do we feel like there's still an opportunity to try again?
Yeah.
We have a dedicated PR team that this is what they do. Miles Meehan is our senior vice president, and I wanted him to come today, but unfortunately he could not make it. We could work with you and kind of do a refresh, a restart, and do a press release, do a new internal newsletter. We have a whole toolkit that prepares all of our cities and our relationships for a mailing before they go out, because as you're saying, it's not untypical that when something brand new goes out, customers are going to say, what is this? Do you know about it? It happens, and we know that over time it goes away. But I think that we have a really good opportunity now to push restart and try some of those PR opportunities and initiatives now ahead of any future mailings.
Mr. Mayor?
Yeah.
Okay. Hi. Thank you. Thank you for being here. Ms. Hayes has already spoken about the no notice of the rollout, so we've been playing catch up with citizens, and I don't have enough digits on my body to tell you the number of emails and the number of phone calls that I have gotten from constituents about this. And I never got a letter. I live in a condo, so I was like, well, I went over to one citizen's house so that I could get a copy of this letter that came out and I could read it. So here are a few of my thoughts. The first sentence of the second paragraph of that letter is enough to make a normal, college-educated person tear their hair out. It says, and I quote, "The exterior water service line that runs from your utility's responsibility to your home is your responsibility as the homeowner." I went, what? You really? I'm a firm believer in the KISS principle. Keep it simple, stupid. Make things in plain English. Make it in short sentences that people can easily understand. The person that sent me this complaint, it says, like, say what? My initial reaction to this mindless wording, until I reread it about eight times, was that this was not only a scam for which the city had fallen, but an incompetent one at that. What does that sentence mean exactly? When you use the word responsibility twice in the same sentence, that you've got to find some better way of getting your point across. There's been not only the initial mailer, there's been a second mailer, and now there's been phone calls that have gone out that basically, to me, seems like hard sell. You know, hurry up and do this, you've got a date. Yes, I understand that, but perhaps if your first letter that came out was a little bit more understandable and wasn't, you know, 3.5 pages of very, very, very fine print, and the city had an opportunity to prepare citizens that this was offering was being made, and that it was, you know, to stress that it was voluntary, I think that we wouldn't have had quite as much drama as we have. That's all I have to say.
Can I ask a question? For the PR, because I want to make sure we give you guys the advance notice you want. Our standard practice, and I believe Sammy communicated to the public works team, was about 1 week in advance. How much in advance would you guys like? A month?
I would expect at least a month, because we need to mention a couple of meetings. We need to put it on the website. So, I mean, a lot of our notices go out, and then we would put it in the mailers for the utility bill, which is, you know, many cycles. So we would probably be 6 weeks, give or take, so that we could put it in the bill, so that those who may not be part of the website or social media have an opportunity to read it, and it comes from us, mm-hmm. mailed to them, to their whatever mailing site they might have with a regular bill, so they can see that we have truly, from a city perspective, endorsed it.
What I'd like to do is let some of the other council people vent a little bit, if you'd like, and this way you can get some, then you get some feedback from some of their concerns and everything at that point would be good. So, Mr. Crail, and
I have.
Oh, you've got them.
My two copies of nearly the same letter, but as Ms. Tillett said, one was had a deadline of December 26th, and then I was granted a reprieve until January 8th, which is a good thing. You know, I voted for this, but I think the implementation, I think it's a good idea, but the implementation has been F-. I think the damage has been done, and I'm prepared to make a motion tonight to terminate the agreement as quickly as we can. I appreciate you being here, but between April or whenever we approve this, the lack of communication, the wording, the perception, I don't think this is repairable.
My turn. I got one of those letters too, and I got calls too. This letter is about missed opportunities. You're in business. You missed an opportunity to work with the city to get people interested in protecting themselves. The city missed an opportunity because we didn't get advance notice of your mailing to make this right before we went to work. I had words like scam. I had words like overreach. I had words like, what the heck is the city doing recommending this company? Missed opportunities. And I'm not sure this far downstream that we can fix it either. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm going to vote to continue to support this organization because it's an option for homeowners. And if homeowners have an option and I say, no, you can't have an option, then I'm too arrogant, and I'm not going to do that to homeowners who could say yes or no, because it's not my choice, it's their choice. But nobody's answered your question yet. Your question was, what can you do to roll out an advanced copy? I don't know what you can do, but what I'd recommend that you consider, assuming this is a continual option for you, is to work with our city manager that essentially manages this city. And we set the policy, and she takes care of the policy management part. And she's the one you should contact, work it out. If you and she can get together, I support it. If you can't, I oppose it. I'd like to see it continue because I don't think it's an option that we should take away from even one homeowner that might want to still have that. But another rollout, it's fine with me. Another process that the manager and you can get together, assuming it survives this meeting tonight, I think is worth a try. But missed opportunity is certainly a word that comes to my mind. But in this day and age, as you certainly, both of you know so well, better than perhaps all of us, the word scam is a buzzword. When something comes on your phone or in your mail or whatever, the first word, if they don't understand it, is, oops, I'm not going to enjoy this experience. I'm going to toss it away. So you've lost a lot of that missed opportunity because of the rollout. So anything you can do to improve the rollout, working with our manager, doing exactly what you and she can get together to do, assuming it survives, I'm all for. Because it's a good idea initially. I do want to see it fail. Thank you.
How many people have signed up for it?
Last week was about nine to ten.
Last week was nine. I don't know if you've had more.
Oh, that's the most up to date.
That's all I know right now.
Okay. I think we can all agree the rollout was pretty poor from what our expectations are. And we consider ourselves some space special, and we do things special ways. And one of them, and one of the things that this council has spent a lot of time on is communication to our citizens. So I think we can agree that that is the biggest part. I do not want to throw the baby out with the bathwater at this point, but I would like to see with our city manager a re-roll out, or whatever you want to call it, with non-artificial timeframes, because to me those timeframes are artificial. I mean, we're in a holiday season and you're asking people to respond back when they've got lots of other things going on. I would hope a couple of months and some time taken to rewrite it. But with that said, I've got a couple of other questions in trying to put the total company in perspective. Your survey satisfaction's at 99%, 90 whatever?
98.6, yeah.
Okay. What is your return rate on your surveys you send out? In other words, if you've got 100 surveys that go out, does that 99% make up a 90 of those 100, or is it 10 of those 100? So, or do you have the database to tell you that?
We have some information that we can pull, but it's typically we attempt to reach 15% of everybody that's had a job. So, for example, in just 2016, we've had over 400,000 jobs completed.
Okay.
So that percentage will go at a minimum, it's 15%. We're actually able to reach via phone. If not, we're using other channels to track information.
Okay, so 400,000, 15% would be 60,000 people, and of those 60,000, 99% were happy. Okay. How are you identifying who your service people are in this area? I mean, that's been one of the questions here, and I think our citizens would want to know. I mean, a lot of times when you have different companies you use, you get a list of who provides services for those companies. So what process, I've got to assume if you're rolling it out, you've already got people on your list from our area to provide the work. So I think we would be very interested, not to speak for the rest of the council, in knowing who the lists are.
So we can certainly provide the list. And also, before launch, one of the first things we do, and we apologies if we did not do that here, is we'll ask you specifically, is there a contractor you don't want anywhere near your residence, because we'll ensure that they don't even make it onto our list to reach out to ask them if they want to go through our process to qualify.
Is that a question asked?
So we, as we, it was asked of the council, and I think at one of the meetings, and as we stipulated, is the city does not recommend anyone. Mm-hmm. We do not get into the business of picking companies or businesses, because you had established that you use the Better Business Bureau. So that was what was presented and left at that.
Well, maybe like to allay some other person's concerns like yours, Mr. Tucker, the information sent to homeowners would be, these are the companies that we use in your area. would that constitute the city endorsing them?
The city doesn't get into that at all.
But if you add on our letter, you know, our logos on that letter, then you'll put a list of companies in there. That's going to be a tacit endorsement of those companies, and I wouldn't agree with that either. So.
And I have to be really honest, we wouldn't recommend it. If a customer calls, we can provide you all with a list at any time. We can, if a customer calls and asks, we actually, when a customer calls to make a claim, our agent will give them the option of a link that they get on their phone. That link tells them who's going to show up at their house and shows them where they're coming en route and a picture of who's actually going to show up. So we are very transparent with the customers. Why we would not want to promote it on websites is because our contractor process is very rigorous. We have regional operations managers located all over who are monitoring and keeping track of all of our contractors via scorecards. If one of our contractors does something that's not to our standards, that represents our company and our partners, they're out. So we would hate to give a list and then someone's out and not have the opportunity to give you those refresh lists. So we'd rather that be provided on an as-need basis if a customer wants to know. We're happy to share that information and show that.
Okay, may I restate my question then? Okay, if I'm hearing you correctly, you presently have a list of companies in this area that would service the residents of Mount Dora. that have gone through your screening process.
Absolutely.
I got one last question, and thank you for coming down tonight.
Thank you.
I was rude and not saying that to begin with, so I apologize. Hypothetically, and I don't know, if a resident of Sorrento, which is about 5 miles down the road, or a resident of another town 10 miles to the north of us, if they wanted to go into agreement as an individual, called you up and say, hey, I want to sign up with your company, could they do it?
Organically, yes. If they find us organically, absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, I think the council had a good opportunity to vent tonight because, and I just let them go because they're asking the same things I was going to be asking, and so there's no sense trying to repeat too much of it. But that was a general complaint, and this camp, the representation that this is Mount Door, you know, going after money grab, 50 cents a sign up, so we make about $4.50 so far at this point. So, but that's mainly our administrative fees and things like that we're going to be doing. But that's not that much of a concern. My concern at this point is if our city manager and our public works department are willing to do a redo, okay? And I'm double, but anyway, to go back and redo this again and how we go about doing it. If you guys want to get together, if that's okay with our city manager, our public works, to go along with that, if you guys want to get together, and have Ms. Hayes come back with another presentation to the council on your suggestions and what you want to work out for the council to consider, I think that would be a good move at this point. And instead of making any kind of decision tonight, which I think is kind of you try not to do knee-jerk type decisions if you can. So if we can come up with something, if you guys can work something out, then the council can make a good informed decision at that point. And if we want to do it, then do another go around with this thing. Because again, I'm agreeing with some of the other comments that it is optional. It's something good. I live in a new house, and so I don't have that worries. But I know there's a lot of older houses, like you said, in the city, and some of them are going to be faced with some high bills. And if there's a small insurance policy that can help out to face some very high costs, I have no problem in having that option available to them. So if that's okay with the council, could I do this?
No.
Okay. Well, that's
no.
Okay.
I'm going to make a motion, and I don't know, is this the appropriate time?
You could.
Sure.
Discussion. It's under discussion only at this point.
You can have a consensus, or if you want, but it wouldn't be a motion.
Okay. Just consensus then. If there's no objection, then we have one.
I object.
So basically, the council is in favor of just going ahead and letting this just come back to the council at a future date for a and approve our city manager. Okay, we have two objections.
If this is going to go ahead and the majority rules, of course, there cannot be a third mailing, follow-up phone calls. I mean, that just rubs salt in the wound. Didn't like the first mailing, we get a second mailing that's just very similar. I didn't receive any phone calls, but if people are receiving phone calls, you have to stop.
Yeah, there should be no phone calls and no additional marketing materials go out without any approval. So this piece was approved to go out, and that's why it was sent out on November 20th. But there's no outbound calling. That's not something we do. So you won't have to worry about that, and then no additional letters will be going out because the original letter, and then there's the reminder letter that go out, and then that's it. So you guys have completed the first campaign fully.
Well, that's nice.
Well, I had a constituent who got a phone call.
Did they sign up for?
No. I mean, he's sitting right here.
They shouldn't have called.
Well, I hung up on it, but I did get the letter, the confusing letter.
So, again, I think we have a consensus then to go ahead and just to have you work with the city manager and our public works department. And if you guys can work something out to do it, if not, then we'll be getting a recommendation from the city manager to discontinue the service then at that point. Okay?
We appreciate it.
Thank you for coming.
We appreciate your time and the opportunity to try and do it over.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Happy holidays.
Y'all have a great day. Hey, again, thank you for making the trip and coming here and hanging around during the holidays. It's a great time here.
Well, I'm not going anywhere. Sorry.
We're from New York. Thank you, Council, for all the great comments. I know this has been at everybody's agenda here for the last couple of weeks. And we've all been engaged with it.
Do we have a timeline for this, or is this just going to be hanging on for weeks and months? Or, I mean, can we deal with this in the form of a motion at the next meeting?
I will definitely have it on the January 2nd as a motion of some type. Whether it's to after having discussion with them, whether or not to cancel or to proceed as a recommendation, whatever it might be, and present something to you so you can make a choice at that point.
Is that enough time for you, or do you want
to? Well, they're here. That ball's in their court.
Okay. Thank you for that. Actually, and we'll do it. We can do that. So be on the next council meeting. Okay. Where are we at here? Sure, somewhere. So. Okay, approval of resolution number 28. We have a whole mess of resolutions. So.
We'll just put them.
We'll go right through them. Can we put this all in one motion? We're going to work. Okay, approval of resolution number 2017-171, agreement between the city of Apopka and the city of Mount Brook to reclaim water interconnect. And Ms. Cockcroft, we have the comment, please.
Yes, sir, Mr. Mayor. Resolution number 2017-171, a resolution of City of Mount Dora, Florida, approving an agreement between the City of Apopka and City of Mount Dora for reclaimed water interconnection, providing for legislative binding and providing for authority to the city manager for implementing administrative actions, providing for authority to the mayor to execute, providing for a savings provision, and providing for scrivener's errors, conflicts, severability, and an effective date.
Thank you, Ms. Hayes.
Thank you, Mayor, Council members. As you will notice on the beginning of this agenda, items 1 through item 9 are all John Peters, Public Works. So rather than have him sitting up and down, if it's okay with you, I'd just like to let him stand here, go through the items. I think wasting time for me to give you a summary of what's going to happen, I'll let him do that. Maybe in his summary, he'll answer some of your questions, and we can kind of move through the process. If you would like, he can discuss each one of them, and then you can read them. Can we do that as long as you address them separately, City Council, City Attorney?
They're all going to need separate motions.
That's fine, but can he go ahead and address each one of them?
We can talk about it all together, yeah.
Is that okay with the City Council?
I was going to ask if I saw separate three of the groups. Okay. The same information applies to all three.
Thank you.
One correction, fire section is number 4.
Well, thank you. Okay. Give you a break.
Yeah, I'm going to talk about the first three items because they're all interrelated. The City of Mount Dora, just a way of background, we have a consumptive use permit for potable water. Today, very dependent on our alternative water program, which right now is reclaimed water. As you all have heard me talk about in the past, March 15th to June 15th is pansy season. That's when everybody goes to Home Depot and buys pansies and they want to water them. And it's also the time of the year that we don't get any rainfall. So we're always running in a deficit for those 3 months. And in fact, since I've been here, we have implemented a spreadsheet. And that spreadsheet tracks all waters. And it confirmed what I learned at Altamont Springs with 20 years worth of data. And that is, during that 3 months from March 15th to June 15th, we augment with the same amount of water that we throw away from June 15th back around to March 15th. If I had a wonderful storage facility like Thrill Hill, we could keep it and then use it when we need it, but I don't have that. We have an augmentation well at wastewater plant number 2 for the purposes of augmenting our reclaim system during that dry period. We are allowed, as of right now, 1 million gallons a day. Starting next month, we have to go down to 750, then we have to go down to 500, then to 250, and then it goes away in 2021. So knowing that we were going to start seeing a reduction in water availability, we started looking at some alternatives. We looked at taking water out of FDOT retention ponds they dry up. That's not an option. But when I was in Altamont Springs, I put a project together over there called the A-Burk Project with the DOT. When you go down I-4 through Altamont, you see Cranesford Park, there's a lake there. And then you go under 436, there's another lake to the left. They're enclosed basins. The water doesn't go anywhere. Altamont actually has a pump system that pumps to the Little Watauga River with very stringent conditions. DOT couldn't figure out how to make the stormwater work, so I came up with the A-FERC project to remove the water out of those two basins, pipe it to Apopka, who at the time had two 250 million gallon storage facilities with rapid infiltration basins above a certain elevation. So it replenished the aquifer, which is very important. We were able to negotiate the deal. Unfortunately, before I left there, we had not been able to work anything out with DOT. Obviously, it's been done. Between the DOT, St. John's, and DEP, I don't think the city of Altamont paid a penny. It's about $13 million project. So I reached out to Apopka because I knew Apopka was negotiating with Orange County on a similar arrangement for Orange County to send that extra clean water. Sure enough, they were. Starting in late 2018, they will be sending 1 million gallons a day to Apopka. In 2019, it'll go to 2 million. In 2020, it'll go to 3 million. Well, the advantage of that is as we grow east and we need more, Orange County is going to be providing it. So this agreement ties us to the Orange County flow. You know, the first year that we have a pipe operational, we'll have 1 million gallons a day, which replaces what we're losing. Part of what we're losing is the wastewater plant. But as we grow, we will still have more water available. So it's a good deal in that particular sense. So the first item is the agreement with the city of Apopka. We will pay them, when we take water from them, we will pay them 60 cents on their lowest customer rate. The theory being it costs more to produce the water than it does to transmit the water. And the number that I've always come up with in my past experience is about 61%, so 60% right there. We negotiate a little bit with it, but we agree 60% is a good number. Now, conversely, when we have excess water, we need to get rid of it. We will send it to them for nothing because they have to store it, they have to deal with it. We probably would not send a whole lot to them unless they have dire need for it, because we have the spray field that we can send the water to. But with this agreement in place, if we ever wanted to make use of the spray field property for something, we can implement that part of the agreement, make the spray field available for, you know, expanding the golf course or whatever it may be. So that's the advantage of that element of disagreement. I got to hand it to the city of Apopka. They were great to work with on this agreement. I drafted the agreement with the city attorney's help, sent it over, and a couple grammatical changes, but nothing of substance in the agreement itself. So I think we have an excellent agreement here that will serve us in the future. The second element is, because we were doing this project with three other municipalities, when you think about it, Altamont, Apopka, and Orange County, and us, a four-party agreement, St. John's was very interested in giving us grant money. And normally, St. John's would give you 30%. But because this project was a continuation of the A-FERC project and Orange County coming in, DEP wanted to come in also. So we're, based on the original estimate, we're getting 50%. Based on the new estimate, we're getting 33%. So what I'm hoping we can do is go back. I talked to Mary Brown at St. John. We can talk about it. I'm hoping that we can get a supplement to this, and I think we can. Ms. Hayes asked me to reach out, and I did, and I got a better response than I expected, so the boss is running in. But anyway, but hopefully we will be able to get that 550 boosted toward the end of this process. So that's the second resolution before you. It's to accept, I'm sure y'all have, don't have a problem with accepting $550,000. And then the third one is the contract with Batch to do the design work so we can get the thing built. The sooner we can get it built, the better we're going to be, because we're going to have a tough year having dropped to 750,000 gallons. We're looking at ways to store water on off days and stuff like that. So I think we can get through this year, but we really be hampered if we have to go beyond this year.
Okay, we have a we have already heard on about the first item, so I want to get a motion for approval for resolution 171.
I so moved. On move.
Second. And any other comments or questions on that item?
Only that I consider 171 and that the following two as I wouldn't say an emergency, but it's certainly an exigent issue that is here to protect the circuitous route we have, certainly at the Country Club of Montour, and all of those things beyond east are really crucial to the development and are crucial to the protection of healthy water for our citizens. So to me, it's an easy call.
So.
Okay, thank you. I have some questions. So besides irrigation, what do we use reclaimed water for?
Irrigation. Now, I will tell you, in other jurisdictions I've worked in, reclaimed water has been used for car washes. They've been used for fountains. Non-essential water use. And if
that's
we,
basically irrigation.
Well, yeah, but if we ever got to the point that we were having trouble with the potable water in terms of the supply of it, that would be an option that we would consider as part of a conservation measure.
What, drinking reclaimed water?
No. Fountain,
oh, gotcha.
Car washes,
gotcha.
And the like.
Okay. So what is Apopka's price for their reclaimed water?
We would be
water?
Paying about 58 cents, I think, at 1,000 gallons.
68 cents, okay.
58 cents.
Okay, because it's
about
when I looked it up online, the cheapest price I could see was 61 cents per 1,000 gallons. And if
yeah,
we pay 60% of it, okay,
that's
so
a,
it's not
an
published.
Agricultural exemption they have from a residential standpoint. It's
okay. So it's not on their website.
Right.
Okay. So what do we expect to pay annually, to pay them annually based on our prior history of shortages?
Based on our prior history, we would be about, let's see, 90 million gallons, which would be 9,000 gallons, 58 cents, roughly
$5,000.
A year?
$5,220.
A year? Okay, all right. Well, I didn't know, so I wanted some sort of reference.
Maybe off a zero, but you got to remember, we make income off that.
That was very good. That was my next question. Will our reclaimed rates recoup the cost that we anticipate paying to a podcast?
Yes, ma'am. We will make 40 cents on the dollar for every bit of
okay.
use.
And why is our augmentation well being reduced?
It's part of the consumptive use permit because they were concerned that it would adversely impact the aquifer. In fact, we have a monitoring program that we do right now to monitor water levels in certain lakes around here to make sure that we are not adversely impacting. If we were, they would actually reduce it quicker.
Okay, and why are we not... How does all of this fit into the bazillions of dollars we've spent on Thrill Hill so far? And the additional $300,000 that's in the budget?
They're actually not related, although St. John's has indicated they really like the concept of Thrill Hill, and I think they are willing to, that is in a different pool of money that can be as much as 75% grants. And they're interested in talking about it. So.
Is that an either-or option, either Thrill Hill or this?
I would prefer not to call it an either-or. I think we need both, ultimately, because as we grow, you know, if we grow like we're talking about up to, you know, if we go to 20,000, 25,000, 30,000, the Altamont with 45,000, and I know how much reclaimed water we were using, and we are nowhere near being able to supply that much right now.
Okay, and so my final thing is, I know that everybody
likes green lawns. But I think at some point, somebody, and I don't know whether it's going to be us here in little old Mountain Door or something, but somebody's got to take a good hard look at what we're spending our water on. And I'm not sure that you know, keeping green lawns is necessarily a very good stewardship of the environment and our precious aquifer. And I guess I just going to urge people to.
Most of them are using reclaimed water to do it.
It doesn't matter. It just, you know, that water's, well, I guess the water's going down into the ground to eventually, you know, replenish the aquifer. But I just have a hard time with the amount of, you know, of water that we use. So
you bring up an excellent point. One of the things we've been talking about with future growth as we expand our utility is we've had some discussions about zoning aspects. For instance, if we go into the JPA area, with the way the county agreement is, they're allowed 2 units per acre. Well, if it's 2 units per acre, that means they're half-acre lots. Kind of like Sullivan Ranch, they use a lot of reclaimed water. Our preference would be that the houses would be clustered in 4 units per acre, and then the remaining half of the property would be left in a natural state where you're not irrigating it. So that would be, we would immediately reduce our irrigation by half if we can work things out in a zoning manner that would help us with regard to that. But I'd share your concern, especially when you look at the reclaimed water use in places like Sullivan Ranch that compared to the rest of the city. It's incredible.
Okay, that's all I have.
Okay. Anybody from the public wish to address this resolution? Seeing none, Ms. Johnson, can I have a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Rolfson?
Yes.
Mr. Crail?
Yes.
Ms. Tillett?
Yes.
Mr. Tucker?
Yes.
Mr. Massey?
Yes.
Ms. Hope?
Yes.
Mayor Jerome?
Yes. Ms. Cockrock, would you please read the title of resolution number 2017-172?
Yes, sir. Resolution number 2017-172, a resolution of the City of Mount Door, Florida, approving a cost-sharing agreement between the St. John's River Water Management District and the City of Mount Door, providing for legislative findings and intent, providing for authority to the city manager for implementing administrative actions, providing for authority to the mayor to execute, providing for a savings provision, and providing for
scrivener's
errors, conflict, severability, and effective
dates.
Have a motion for approval of this resolution?
So moved. Second.
Any questions, additional questions from the council on this item? Seeing none, anybody from the public wish to address this issue?
I have a question based on public.
Please, come on up. Okay. State name and address, please.
Taylor Jones, 1035 North Unser Street. Nobody should know me, but everybody knows where I live, which is right across from the Ice House Theater. A question I'm probably just based on ignorance, but regarding reclaimed water, I see signs in my neighborhood here and there, not on my block, I have an irrigation system, and I'll see these signs, we use reclaimed water. Now, I've never lived somewhere where I've had an irrigation system using, is the water in all the irrigation systems in town reclaimed? So how do I know? Can I assume that I don't have reclaimed water because there's no sign?
That's a good question for Mr. Peters to answer. Thank you for your question.
Good question. Typically the easiest way to tell is if you have 1 meter or 2 meters.
Okay.
If you have 2 meters, you're likely on reclaimed water. If you only have 1 meter, you're more likely to be just strictly potable. Now, there are some people that have powerful irrigation meters.
I have 2 meters. I do not have reclaimed water.
For a while, we were doing potable irrigation meters also. But when you look at your water bill, it will show potable water use or reclaimed water use. And that will tell you.
Sounds like the answer is check your water bill.
In Lakes Mount Door, we have all reclaimed. And we have no meters for it. So. Okay, so to the public. Anybody else from the public? Seeing none, Ms. Johnson, may I have a roll call vote, please?
Yes. Mr. Crail?
Yes.
We haven't had any discussion, did we?
Yeah, we asked for discussion.
Yeah, we did discussion. We asked for discussion.
This is on the interconnect.
It's on the money.
Yeah.
On the money. 172.
172.
Yeah, that one. Oh.
That's for the money.
Got it. Sorry. I'm behind myself.
Mr. Tucker?
Yes.
Mr. Massey?
Yes.
Mr. Rolfson?
Yes.
Ms. Tillett?
Yes.
Ms. Hoax?
Yes.
Mayor Jerome?
Yes. And Ms. Cockrock, I have the title read for resolution number 2017-173.
Yes, sir. Resolution number 2017-173, a resolution of City of Mount Dora, Florida, authorizing a piggyback contract and scope of services for professional engineering services with Booth, Armstrong, and Hyatt Besh to design the reclaimed water and interconnection provided for legislative bodies in intent, providing for authority to the city manager for implementing administrative actions, providing for authority to the mayor to execute, providing for savings provision, and providing for scrivener's errors, conflict severability, and effective date.
Thank you. Have a motion for approval?
So moved.
Second. Thank you. Any comments, questions, further on this item from the council? Ms. Tillett.
Yeah, I guess I just have to object, to be spending almost $791,000 to water lawns. I just think that's a lot of money. Right? Isn't it $550,000 to the pipeline? Is that $246.50 that's over and above the $550?
$246. Yeah. No. The $550 is the grant from St. John's and DEP.
And $550 comes from us.
Actually, our number is going to be closer to $1 million because of the interconnect point. We have to do very substantial pumping, valving operations. It's going to be expensive. And then you have the $246.50.
Was that in the SIP?
It was in the original report.
In the CIP, she's asking, do we have it in last year's CIP?
No, they would not. We've been looking for a solution to our augmentation well being downgraded each year, and this is the solution that we found.
So I would like to say, though, one thing on that. This is for Besh to actually do the engineering piece of it, and then the project needs to come back to you for approval and funding at that point in time for the difference in whatever we might receive from St. John's and the DEP, I guess. So, again, the project needs to still come back to you. This is an engineering piece. Obviously, the interconnect actually does a couple things, water coming into the city as well as possibly in the future potable water going back to Apopka if they need it. That was one of the things we talked about several months ago, is that we also fix or design it in such a way that they can also receive potable from us if they need it in an emergency, which they would pay for that. We also talked about possible potable.
So is this going to be potable also, or potable? Or?
Okay.
We're just going blank. Going back to a pot.
You could, yeah.
Okay, but I guess I'm just sort of, you know, that's a lot of money.
Mr. Crail?
I'm done.
Well, it just occurs to me, and I agree, it's a lot of money and it's a lot of water, and we have to be very careful with both. But the alternative is to use potable water that costs a great deal more, and the places in town that have the opportunity to use reclaimed water, I think that's more environmentally sound than potable water. So
I agree. You know. I still say it seems like we're hot on this. You know, for a couple of years we were hot on Thrill Hill, and now it's sort of fallen off the radar. And
Thrill Hill still going through the process of getting a permit from the county. Remember, we had to get a mining permit. Our intention is to put it on the street with DOT roadway contractors.
Right.
To remove dirt and do grading for it, so the cost would be substantially less. And then with the St. John DEP grant on that project, the cost to us could be very little.
It doesn't even show up in the budget.
No, not
it's on there, but it's not in any year. We don't have any active plans.
plan, I guess, per year to do anything with it.
Right, until we have some engineering back and have some of this results back. I believe when we talked about it this past year, we could not associate a dollar amount with it, and at the same time did not have a complete scope. So there needs to be some discussion of the CIP when we go through the water side of that about what you wish to do as far as Thrill Hill. Now, as far as this piece here, also, again, engineering first, and then we'll come back to project. If you decide to hold it at that point in time until other additional funding is found, that's something we can choose to do.
And if I may say, as we get down a little further, we probably need to have a workshop to discuss how the reclaim and the public will work together, because our consumptive use permit right now for public has Thrill Hill in it as a condition. And it has the augmentation well at Bridgewater Plant 2. If we get a little further along, we're probably going to need to go back and revisit that consumptive use permit to put the Apopka interconnect in and make some modifications on the balance of it. But our future ability to get water right now is tied to the augmentation well and Thrill Hill in the agreement. So what we're trying to do here is to get ourselves in a better position to go renegotiate.
So we don't have any pipes that come out of Thrill Hill to feed the...
The closest pipe is in the entrance of Lakes and Outdoor.
Also, if you recall, part of this is...
So the answer is no.
...related a little bit to ISBA, because we're also looking at some areas out there and some possible future acquisitions, as well as the Innovation District. So there's a lot of moving pieces and parts that can make some of this very... positive for the city.
But I like your suggestion, Mr. Peters. We all need a better understanding, and it's very complex. So on our list of 87 upcoming workshops, let's add an 88th and so we each understand.
Well, Mr. Massey has an advantage, because we just went out last week, and he had him do it 2 hours of me talking about how it all worked together. He's probably well versed.
My thanks to John for his orientation tour, because it almost word for word followed the agenda for this week. I was very impressed.
You can be tested later on that. And any other council comments right now? Anybody from the public wish to address?
Thank you, Mr. Peters.
Hang on a second.
Mike Masterson, 7887 Crosswind Way, and I apologize for the hat, but I'm having some treatments done to my head regarding skin cancer, and you all don't want to really see what the top of my head looks like at the present time. So, the hat's after the first. In regards to your concerns, Ms. Tillard, about the recycled water, a principle of that we're trying to operate on now is reduce, reuse, and recycle. If we reuse the water, we're getting a second generation out of it. The third thing is we're putting it, there is some evaporative loss, but we are replenishing the aquifer with that portion of water that goes in the ground and stays in the ground and seeps back down and ultimately gets back to the aquifer. So we've replaced it. We're replacing it. And so I think there's value in that. The second thing is, if we go to xeriscaping like Arizona, et cetera, we're experiencing global warming. Green grass and the trees, et cetera, help to cool our planet. Anybody who stood underneath a tree versus standing in the sun will understand how our planet will be cooler if we have a lot of trees, et cetera, around it. So I think there's value in not going to the Arizona type of landscaping. But also, the Arizona landscaping with lots of stones is pretty hot, because that's reflective as opposed to absorptive. And lastly, the green grass and all of those trees help our photosynthesis, which helps us with carbon dioxide. And converting the carbon dioxide into oxygen. And again, we all need oxygen. So I think there's value in doing it. I understand your philosophical objections to doing it, but I think we get something out of it that pays, that gives us value for the money we're spending. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments, Jack.
Thank you, Mike.
Thanks for your comments.
I'm not sure grass actually cools your carbon.
Anybody else for the public wish to address?
Yes, I agree.
Well, you can have the choice of walking across the grass barefoot, you can walk across your driveway barefoot. I think I'd rather walk across my grass.
Or I could wear shoes.
But
But understand, again, the impact on global warming.
Yes.
I understand.
Okay. Anybody else from the public wish to address this resolution? Seeing none, back to council. Any other comments?
One quick one. On this specific one, it said that Besh will be doing the drawings and design and construction administration services. I thought that we were going to start using an independent project manager for most of these projects, or is that only on highway type things?
No, we will be using some project managers on large projects. Again, what this comes in at, based on the dollar value, and we bring it back to council, we'll bring back a suggestion of either a project manager or for them to do it.
Okay.
I think we need to see what they bring back to us first, and then you have that opportunity.
Okay. I was just curious as to whether we were
just a little ahead right now.
I think some of the large projects we definitely need assistance in, and John needs assistance in
right.
his group.
Because I think we approved that.
Well, you did on several of the large road projects. But I think this one, again, right now, best good at the value, but maybe it's going to change when they go through the engineering, so we need to look at that.
You are 100% correct. We have been going to another firm doing the construction management. But because we have an agreement with APOPCA has a comfort level with Dash. And so we are using Besh on this partly because of our agreement with APOPCA, because APOPCA has to use the end product also, and they want to have a comfort level that it meets their standards too.
Okay, thanks. Okay.
It will also be in the agenda item when you see it, though. You would definitely approve it at that point.
Ms. Johnson, may I roll call, please?
Sure. Mr. Rolfson?
Yes.
Mr. Tucker?
Yes.
Mr. Crail?
Yes.
Mr. Massey?
Yes.
Ms. Tillett?
Yes.
Ms. Hoax?
Yes.
Mayor Jerome?
Yes. And need approval of resolution number 2017-176, notice of intent for the fire assessment fee. Ms. Cockcroft, we have Kyle Ripley.
Yes, sir. Resolution number 2017-176, a resolution of City of Mount Jerome, Florida, electing to use the uniform method of collecting non-ad valorem special assessments levied within the incorporated area of the city, stating a need for such levy, providing for mailing of this resolution, and providing an effective date.
Thank you, Ms. Hayes.
Yes, thank you, Mayor, Council members. As we spoke earlier tonight in the work session, this is the fire assessment fee request for notice of intent. John McKinney, the finance director, is here before you to answer questions and give you a quick summary of it, even though I know we did that earlier. We'll do it for one more quick time.
Mayor, Council, good evening. I'm going to get a motion for approval, please.
I'll so move.
Second. Okay. Mayor, Council, at this evening's workshop, we discussed a couple of trifecta items regarding the fire fee, growth, future needs, and funding. This notice of intent resolution has been a gargantuan task that I will try to concisely explain. Per Florida Statute 197, we are required to advertise four times prior to this evening's council meeting this notice of intent. This notice of intent on the fire assessment fee is strictly the notice of intent. We're not trying to discuss this evening the amount of the fee, how long the fee is to be implemented, etc. Strictly the notice of intent. That once passed, we will take this and provide it to the Department of Revenue, the tax collector, and the property appraiser. So with that, if there's any questions, I will try to explain them.
Mr. Tucker?
So tonight, it's simply the notice of intent.
No more, no less. We will come back to you no less than five times between now and September 30th.
I'm good.
Perfect.
Any other comments from council?
Okay, I'm sorry to hog the mic tonight. So, I think the wording in this document about provides a funding mechanism to help shore up current operational shortfalls is what brought me up short. Because we don't have... We have a high-level end-of-year budget, et cetera. I'm wondering what kind of operational shortfalls we have. It says current operational shortfalls, so I'm sort of wondering about that. And Also, it was my understanding that the fire assessment fee was only to be used for capital items, so there was no, you know, operations O&M type of money. It was not for O&M. So if this is, when we come back to talk about this, it would be helpful to have all of that clarified.
That's what you're going to do.
At the workshop, yes, ma'am, you brought that up. Let me explain the memo the way best I believe I can. To me, the shoring up operational needs is not about paying for salary and benefits. As when you took the tour and you saw Station 35, operationally, we need to make enhancements. It's not about operational needs of salary and benefits. It's the operational need of a new fire station that can take us into the next 20 to 40 years. Our current resolution is strictly for capital outlay. The original resolution was $2,500 or a service life of greater than 1 year. Our purchasing policy changed that to $5,000 in 1 year. So where we take our next fire assessment fee will be strictly voted on by council. Last time it only allowed for capital outlay. Y'all might make the decision to make it useful for other things. That is not a staff recommendation. It's all in your court on where we take it next.
Thank you for that clarification. I can understand my thing.
Absolutely.
And what I will say is that from the term operational, we will from now on, based on the report, Fitch, because they use the word operational also, as well as the memo, we will be concise that we're all using it the same way to make sure that there's not a confusion of what's being referred to, because Fitch actually responded to it a little differently. So we'll make sure we do that.
Any other comments from council? Seeing none, anybody from the public wish to address this resolution? Seeing none, we have roll call vote. Ms. Johnson.
Mr. Rolfson?
Yes.
Mr. Crail?
Yes.
Mr. Tucker?
Yes.
Mr. Massey?
Yes.
Ms. Tillett?
Yes.
Ms. Hoax?
Yes.
Mayor Jerome?
Yes. Approval of resolution number 2017-170. How far down?
Items 5, 6,
7,
8, 9 will all be Mr. Peters.
Okay. I'll read that first one we did before. At this point, we have the Tower Redford 2017